want to change, they say that you should have at least these 8 things, if not anything else. What is that? The first one is pedagogical knowledge. When I say that, I mean a basic content knowledge. And of course, the humility to accept that we do not know many things and we can learn it from someone else. Very, very important. If that humility is not there, we can never be a good learner. And of course, the vision that you will grow for yourself, you will grow for your institution, and most importantly, you will grow for your students. Collaboration is the way forward. It has been identified as a 21st century skill. We have to do it together as a team. That is when we will be more impactful in solving problems of the society. And of course, there should be a sense of priority that what you need to do first, right? There are so many things that you want to do. Please prioritize your wants as a teacher and make a list that first let me do this and then I will go to something else. And diverse perspectives are very, very important, because especially now, since the National Education Policy has come up with a flexible choosing of subjects for teachers, for students, you have to ask yourself, are you equipped for this kind of a multidisciplinary approach in teaching your subject? Or are you going to say that, no, I know only about social science, don't ask me about biology? Are you going to be rigid like that? Are you going to teach in with a silos mentality like that? Is something that all of us need to ask ourselves. And finally, of course, there should be a balance between work and home, or your personal life and professional life, because many of them give up their professional development because they're not able to balance. They give too much of importance either to their home or to their work, which is why it becomes kind of tilted and then they give up. So we need to bring a balance, and we need to plan in such a way that both of it is not affected, because our families are as important as our work. Right now, I am doing a MOOC myself, sir. I'm doing a course called English for Journalism. Wonderful. So thousands and thousands of students all over the world are part of this course, and there is so much of participation from all of us. And it is a time-bound program where they say that you have 6 weeks, you have 8 weeks. There are modules, there are quizzes for us to do. And after we do that, we get a completion certificate which says that we have gone through 8 weeks of this course. So this is free of cost, so we need not pay this.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, so this is something that all of us can do at our end. You know, every day, 30 minutes you dedicate for yourself. I have already done 6 online courses from the time the pandemic has started. So I would not recommend any particular platform, sir, because these courses are available on different platforms, like Canvas Learn has a few courses, Udemy has a few different courses, Univariety has a few different courses. So you will have to go online and check which is the course you want, what suits you, the time and everything, and you can choose, because all of them are good. They're all very, very reputed platforms. So I would suggest that you please explore what would suit you best as far as the time and the content is concerned. What are the roadblocks that we have for professional development? The first one is lack of will. You know, when I put it here, I just thought of my grandmother, who's no more with me. May her soul rest in peace. She would always tell me that, Anu, there are some diseases which have no treatment. And I thought that lack of will is one such disease that nobody can do anything about. If you don't have a will, nobody can help you, you know, get motivated to grow, to learn, to progress, and to equip yourself with new skills. Some of them find no purpose also. They say that, how is it useful to me? Anyway, I'm teaching, my children are doing well, we are getting a good board result, so why should I grow? So they see no purpose. Well, for that, I would say that the next point, which is lack of awareness, is the problem, because we are not aware of how the education system is evolving, not only in India, but abroad also. Many of our children are going to go out of our country to study. So are we preparing our children for that? Then sometimes there is lack of help, which is personal and professional. Some managements do not support teachers to take up courses. And sometimes personal help also they don't get, so they keep putting off professional development. Negativity is again, you know, what does professional development value to my salary is what they think, or they feel that it's just a waste of time, there's no need. So negativity is again something that we need to get over. Time constraint, I have written no longer relevant, because now all these courses that I spoke about online, you just have to dedicate 2 to 4 hours a week. And I don't think anybody can say that they cannot devote 2 to 4 hours for themselves. So time constraint is no longer relevant, I feel, even monetary issue, because most of the courses are free of cost. You need not spend the money. You get your badges, you get your certificates. Most importantly, there is learning. And the last one, of course, certificate, please. Many times I've seen now that after the pandemic has broken, many teachers will attend any workshop or any seminar only if there is a certificate. Now, you know, is a certificate more important than learning is what I want to ask. Sometimes even if that session is not relevant to us, we attend because we get a certificate. What is the value of a piece of paper if we are not acquiring skills? So these are the roadblocks which we have to get over so that professional development happens without any break. A quote from Abraham Maslow, who says, one can choose to go back towards safety or forward towards growth. Growth must be chosen again and again. Fear must be overcome again and again. I became a teacher not by choice, but by chance only. You know, somebody told me there's a leave vacancy, why don't you join? And I joined, and my husband happened to keep traveling to different states because of his nature of job. And wherever I went, I found that teachers' jobs were always available. So, you know, that is how it started off. Today I can't think of anything else other than being a teacher. So what is very, very important here, Swamiji, is to first think whether you are doing justice to your interaction with the children. That is the first and last question any teacher should ask herself. Because as on today, you rightly pointed out that knowledge or information is available at a click away. Children don't need teachers to teach them what photosynthesis is or to teach the meaning of Romeo and Juliet. In fact, there are online resources which do better than us. So what is our role as a teacher? Our role as a teacher is to motivate the child to be an eternal learner. How do you do that? You do that by being a role model yourself. You know, I keep sharing my children that today I'm very happy children today because I finished this. And can you see the badge I got today after I finished the source, this course? And the children are like, oh my God, this old woman is still interested in learning. What are we doing? We're all very young. We need to keep studying. So the best way to motivate yourself is you have to keep asking yourself, am I doing justice to the children for whom I am here? Because you are a teacher for the children, not for anyone else, right? Yeah. It's not for the parents. It is not for anything else. It is for the children. So if you keep asking this question every day in the morning, and I'm a firm believer of reflective teaching also, Swamiji, where I feel at the end of the day, you have to spend 5 minutes, just 5 minutes, and just say, did everything go well in the class today? Was I able to satiate my child's keen enthusiasm to learn? Was I able to ignite that spark that he has to find more information? You as a teacher need not give all the information, but you have to ignite that spark and tell the child that, come on, go and look for this information. Many times when, even though I know something, I tell the children, I really don't know, I've not come across. Tomorrow can anybody find out this and let me know? So there are many ways in which you can keep learning yourself, and you have to keep motivating yourself by telling that I am going to do this for my children. I'm going to do this for my children. I don't think any other motivation is required to be on path or on track, Swamiji. This is what is my opinion. I remember one of your conversations only in one previous session where you told all of our teachers have been thrown into the water. Now they have to learn to swim. Right. So I could relate to that statement so well that if you're going to wait for an opportunity to learn something, that is never going to happen, because what is the opportunity? Right. The opportunity comes when you anticipate problems, and you need to make this every day. You know, I have heard that very famous people like Bill Gates or Sundar Pichai, they all dedicate 5 hours a week to do something for themselves. So we need to dedicate some time for ourselves also. Although I know for teachers, it is not easy. You know, it is easier said than done, that you have to take out time. It is very difficult, but you should make it a point that, okay, let me spend 30 minutes a day, right? Sometimes you won't believe I'm listening to lessons even while I'm cooking. In the kitchen, I keep my laptop open, I'm listening and I'm cooking. I'm sure if you have a will, there is a way to make time. And it should start from day one, Swamiji. You cannot wait that, okay, let me finish 10 years of my teaching, then I will see what I need to, because every day the system is evolving. Today, yeah, the whole world is running on data. So as soon as you see numbers, you should be able to interpret that to your advantage. Mm-hmm. So it is very, very important. And you rightly pointed out that many of us suffer from technophobia. As soon as I say technology, we take a step back. Well, if you're not ready to evolve, to love technology, please note all teachers, you are going to perish. you know, there is data that says that out of all the professions that are going to disappear because of automation, teaching is going to remain there. Only 30% of the teachers will go. Who are these 30% of teachers? They are teachers who do not want to evolve. If you do not want to evolve, you are going to perish. If you want to remain in the system, you should evolve. Because many times we ourselves stay away from technology, and many parents also tell us the minute we give them some kind of a project to be done, ma'am, what is this? You are encouraging my child to sit in front of the screen. Well, whether you give them a project or you don't give them a project, children are going to sit in front of the screen, right? So the secret is, how are you going to engage the children to such an extent where they do what they have to do and then they're tired? They say, now I cannot work on the screen anymore. So as a teacher, you should know how to engage them digitally so that they are able to focus on the positives of digital use. And for that, you yourself as a teacher should be a digital user also. You cannot do, many times I've seen, Swamiji, with all due respects to all teachers, many times I've seen that even in the classes, for them to switch on the smart board, they have children only coming. The teacher will say, yeah, come on, yeah, switch it on, bring up, yes, my presentation. What is the message you're giving the children that, I don't want to use technology? So obviously you are giving a message to the children that you can use technology the way you want. As a proactive teacher, you have to use, or you have to give assignments to children in such a way that they use it for so long that they are doing your projects, they are pulling out information or whatever. After that, see, too much of anything is too bad for children, and even children also realize, you like, for example, they like ice cream. It doesn't mean that they'll eat a gallon at once. They can only take as much as they can. So we as teachers should engage the children in a positive way so that they are engaged, for them to know how we can use the digital platforms for their positive growth, because they are going to be, and anyway, they are all native digital users. They were all born into, digital gadgets and everything else. So it is our responsibility to educate them that there is a positive use of something, there is a negative use of something, and we can only do it by being role models. For motivation, I don't look at anything outside of me. Motivation should be intrinsic. And every day I tell myself in the morning that, what am I going to do? At the end of the day, I sit and say, what did I do? So you have to motivate yourself. You cannot let external forces either motivate you or even depress you, because we do not have any control over what is happening around us, right? But we do have control about how we think, how we want to stay positive, because at the end of the day, you have to tell yourself that it could be worse. You know, I tell myself, I tell all my team of teachers that this could have been worse. This too shall pass. Stay positive. We are all in a very happy place. Look at all the people who are suffering. So you have to keep motivating yourself that you have been given this noble opportunity of touching lives of children. How many people get that opportunity? You know, it is a calling, I feel, to be a teacher, although many of us have joined this profession by chance, but I feel it is a calling for each one of them to continue in this profession, because there are so many professions. For a person like me who can write reasonably well, who can speak, who knows English, I'm sure there are other possibilities for me to engage myself, but I feel that this is a calling for me, and you know, I have been blessed by the Almighty to touch lives. So every day, if I'm able to motivate a particular teacher to learn something new, if I'm able to make a child realize that he is meant for bigger things, I feel that my life is worthwhile. So I look for motivation to grow within myself. How am I able to contribute? How can I, motivate my team of teachers? How can I, whenever anybody asks for help, if they ask me one thing, I tell them 10 things. Because I feel that knowledge grows only by sharing. So, and there are so many people who call up and say that, ma'am, it is because of you I did this. Ma'am, you motivated me. What else motivation do you need when people are telling me that I was able to, make them think how to grow? So this is my reason to be the way I am. And even for my happiness, I say that I am responsible for my happiness. If I want to be happy, I can be happy. If I want to be unhappy, I will be unhappy. So all of you out there, please look for motivation within yourself. There is nobody who's going to come and motivate you the way you motivate yourself. So now, what is critical thinking? Critical thinking is nothing but skills to solve a problem. How are you going to transfer your classroom learning into everyday life? That itself is critical thinking. where you are using the knowledge you get from textbooks to solve everyday problems. So the best way, the easiest way to develop critical thinking is to connect the children to the outside problems and challenges. You may be giving the best lessons inside the classroom, but if you do not take them out into the outer world, because many of our children are growing in very protected and pampered environments. So if you are thinking that you're going to teach critical thinking inside the classroom, I'm afraid that is not going to be possible to a large extent. Take them out of the classroom. There may be a problem in your own school, right? There may be a problem outside of the school. There may be a problem in the community. There may be a problem in Bangalore. Take them out and make them interact with these problems so that they come up. And believe me, when children are exposed to such problems, they come up with better solutions than adults. What else is critical thinking? Critical thinking is nothing but encouraging children to use their knowledge to solve problems. So please take them out of their classes. Design projects where they have to think outside of the lesson. Don't just restrict to question answers and say that you are done. Please think of innovative ways of teaching the lesson and connect it to everyday life. That is a sure shot success to develop critical thinking in the child, whether he likes to study, doesn't like to study, but he would love to go out and use his skills to solve problems for someone. More important than learning is unlearning, because our brain also can take only that much. If you're going to accumulate all the lessons that you learned when you were a small girl and say that this is relevant even today, you will not be able to learn new things. So, you know, this happened when I went to the US on my Fulbright scholarship. When I went there, I thought that I knew everything that I had to as a teacher. But believe me, when I went to the US, where I had to teach in a school in California, I just realized how ill-equipped I was to teach those children in the US. There are days when I've actually cried and said, how do I engage them, right? So what I had to do was I had to unlearn what I had learned back in India, and I had to learn new ways of engaging these children, you know, content, task-based learning, content-based learning, teaching grammar communicatively. All these things are some things that I learned new. It would not have been possible had I not moved away from what I was doing for so long, which I thought was good enough. So it is very, very important. That is a cycle, actually. You learn, you unlearn, you relearn, right? So unless and until this cycle, this dynamic cycle is always in progress, you can never learn new things. So very, very important to unlearn and relearn. And unlearning should not consume so much of your productive time also. Once you have realized that this is not working out too well, when you reflect upon your daily lessons and you feel that what worked with a batch some 2 years ago is not working with this batch, you just need to innovate yourself and think of one of an out-of-the-box ideas to come out with something new. So unlearn should happen with a very conscious state of mind. Why do you want to bridge the generation gap? You know, this generation gap is a very, very overhyped term, which I feel, because if you think of our parents and grandparents and our children and grandchildren, there is something that all of us can bring to the table, right? What my grandfather can contribute to a conversation, I cannot. What I can do, the children cannot. What the children can do, I cannot. So somewhere I feel that generation gap is not to be so much focused on bridging, because the difference in generations will come only when we are rigid about what we believe in. So once all of us are ready to look at another perspective, in my presentation also I was talking about different perspectives, we should be open to look at the same problem from another's view also. What is their perspective? Is it possible? So when you do that, there is no generation gap. So there's no need to focus so much on bridging generation gap. It's all about how many steps you are ready to walk and how many steps the younger. And when you walk, the children also walk towards you. So that is mutual. And it is very important for us to make the children understand that, you know, there is something that the old people can contribute, which you cannot. Like, for example, last week I taught a lesson called Ranga's Marriage for Grade 11, written by Masti Venkatesh Iyengar. So that story was written somewhere in 1910. So I told the children, if you have grandparents in your house or you have some old relatives, even if they're not in their house, call them up and ask them what is the story behind their marriage. If you thought that it was very simple, it was an arranged marriage, very boring, I said you will fall off your chair when you listen to their interesting stories. So talk to them, and when they spoke to them, they came back with such interesting stories and said, ma'am, we were quite shocked to know that this is what happened before behind them getting married. So somewhere I made them respect their grandparents for what they had to contribute. So all of us have to understand that all the generations, and many times we as adults also write off what the younger ones say. No, you know nothing. We know, we have seen life better. It is not like that. There are some things which they know better than us. So learn that from them. You teach them what you have and tell them that together, let us create a world of knowledge. I'm sure nobody would have a problem with that. And multitasking is not only with the children. You also as a teacher should be multitasking. You should be able to teach. You should be able to evaluate. You should be able to counsel. You should be able to meet parents. You should be able to go out with them. So multitasking is for all of us. Don't we all multitask? So it's not only for the younger ones.